Hi guys, and welcome to Chairboys 1887. I'm here today with Russell Thomas. He's a very loyal supporter, just like myself and some of the previous guests we've had on. All of the previous guests we've had on, I should say. And I'm going to talk to him a bit today about his history as a supporter and how he got involved with it and why he loves the club that we all love so much. So Russell, first of all, thank you very much for coming
thank
on, mate.
Thank you very much for having me, mate. Thank you.
Just sort of a quick footnote to what we're about to talk about. How do you think the events that have gone on with the transfer window and things, how do you think we've coped with losing players such as Matt Ingram and not as many as we all thought we were going to lose?
To be honest, Liam, we've been around, all of us now, long enough to know that it's a formality. Players move on,
of course.
It's a fact. The only thing is, obviously, the manager, Gareth, has now got to find the replacements.
Yeah.
One of the big things, which I'm sure all the supporters will miss, yeah, is the fact that we've lost our youth setup, which I can't stress enough. As soon as we can get it back, we need it back.
Definitely.
The amount of money we've made through players being sold on plus sell on fees is probably kept the club afloat. You know, there's no escaping that.
Of course.
To answer your question, players move on. Obviously, we want them to do the best. You know, at the end of the day, football's a short career. If you can earn decent wages, playing in front of big crowds, showcasing your talents, then all the power to them. And
of course,
wish them all the best.
Of course. As do I, and I'm sure most supporters will do to Matt Ingram, as he's just tried or he's just started sort of breaking into the first team at QPR, and he'll be hopefully on the bench at the weekend and pushing the first choice keeper all the way. Okay, so in terms of the incomings that we've made, I know they're not permanent transfers. We've got the wing wizard Paris Cowan-Hall has returned for the rest of the season. We've got Jason McCarthy, who has signed a loan deal, I shouldn't say permanent, a loan deal to the rest of the season, and also the new goalkeeper Ryan Alsop. What are your views on the three that have come in?
Paris was a shock, to be honest. I turned up for the his re-debut, and they were handing out the team sheets.
Yeah.
And me, my dad, and my brother were laughing because we thought it was a misprint.
Yeah, of course.
You know, who's done this? Because there was nothing on the website in the morning.
Yeah.
We hadn't heard anything, so it must have been a last-minute thing.
Of course.
He seems to give us something that we haven't got at the moment. He's quick. Good in the air.
Yeah.
It's just whether he's utilised correctly, to get the best out of him.
Definitely.
Obviously, the injury-prone situation is a potential stumbling block,
yeah,
but obviously that's the risk you take. Obviously, fans' favourite just before we left, so
yeah,
that would help smooth over the departure of Matt to Queen's Park Rangers.
Of course. Do you think that it's sort of a case of deja vu? I mean, when he played the last game against Luton, I thought, wow, it's like he'd never been away. Because he literally made all the, he made all the same movements that he made before he left to Millwall. It was like he'd never gone away, and he was doing exactly the same things that had caught Millwall's eye.
Well, when you look at the personnel who were here just when he left, with the exception of the odd few players who were on loan,
yeah,
who have moved on, it's virtually the same spine. So, like you say, it's almost like he went on an extended holiday.
Yeah.
So, and his game will never change. He will always make the same runs. You know, very good, hard worker off the ball.
Yeah.
It seems to be one of the manager's traits.
Yeah.
I'm all for pressing high. At the end of the day, I can't emphasise enough how many goals are scored through winning the ball in the final third. You look at a lot of the football at the top level these days, and this thing in vogue at the moment, which is one up front, To me, I think it's a complete waste of time because centre-halves now can literally just have a cigar when they're on the ball.
Yeah, exactly.
And their defensive capabilities aren't tested in the way that they should be.
Yeah, definitely. Teams like Watford and to some extent Bournemouth and Crystal Palace, are all those kind of teams that are in the same sort of position are all playing that kind of that kind of football, and you can see why it works.
But on top of that, also when you retrieve the ball, it's also imperative that you retain it. It's no good winning it and then just giving it straight back.
Yeah.
Because then you're leaving yourself in a predicament where you're just going to tire yourself, and good teams will pick you off later in the game.
Of course. Yeah, definitely. And I mean, that's we've sort of picked up, or maybe started a trend of playing that kind of way. We did it first, not anybody else. I think that we sort of played that football long before anybody else did it, and maybe they've sort of seen the success of lower league teams using it, and have caught on to the idea and tried it in the Premier League, and it's obviously worked. Moving on swiftly, we just wanted to maybe talk about some of your first memories. You very kindly provided me with some notes prior to the interview to sort of help me gauge sort of a history of your sort of interest in the club. So if we sort of maybe go from maybe relatives who have followed the club, what sort of things can you tell me about their influences on or why they followed the club maybe?
Well, as far back as I can remember, my dad, Terry, he started watching Wickham. He told me his very first game at Lokes Park was in the, I believe it would have been the late 60s. And he started going regularly around the early 70s with his school friends and work colleagues.
Yeah.
And to quote, it was basically something to do.
Fair enough.
I still find that quite comical when he says that to me. But the reality is, back then, obviously, the media coverage, television, all that sort of thing was virtually nil.
Yeah.
In regards to football, you basically had match of the day with your old Division 1 highlights.
Of course.
You had the big match on the opposite channel.
Yeah.
And you probably had one live game a week if you were lucky, plus the FA Cup final.
Yeah.
So to get your fix, as it were, you had to come, for those who live locally, you would go up to Lokes Park to watch the game. Or if you followed someone, say a London team, Tottenham, Arsenal, Chelsea, somebody like that, you would pop on the train down to London. And it wasn't unheard of that they would go, if Wickham weren't playing, they would go up to Flackle Heath, or they would go and watch Marlowe, just to get their fix.
Because
at the end of the day, there's something about lower league football that, you recognise the faces, you would have like a raffle on the terrace, you would just know people. It was something a little bit more intimate. If you know what I mean.
Similar to things that maybe happen today, like the 50-50 half-time draw, which I've not won yet. To those of you who are watching and have any say in those things, I haven't won that yet, and I'd quite like to. Though maybe those kind of things are sort of brought through generations as well, and a sort of a maybe like a lasting sort of memory of the years that have gone by, the things like the 50-50 draw and buying programmes and things and all that kind of stuff. I know that it's I do always try and make an effort to buy one, if it's not on the match day, maybe in the week after the game, because they are printed in quite a large number, as sort of a memento of the day. And if I'm lucky enough to go in the boxes, then a team sheet and things like that, and they're all passed through. So things like that are always good to sort of keep hold of and bring through and keep bringing through, which means that we haven't completely lost touch with previous.
Well, another thing on that regard, one thing with following your local team is it's sort of a sense of belonging. It's going back to the sort of the tribalism sort of thing.
Yeah.
It's having pride in your history and where you come from and the people you live next to.
Oh, definitely.
You know, and there's something that's sort of lost in just following a team from the armchair who just happens to be in your country's top division.
Of course.
You know? Obviously, if you want to see the most expansive football, then obviously you want to go and see the top teams.
Of course, yeah.
But at the end of the day, there's more to it than that. You know, it's the struggle of who's going to win, and you know.
Yeah, definitely. I do sort of as probably some of you will know, I do follow a team in the Premier League, Manchester United, who are under increasing pressure at the minute, but I'm predominantly Wickham, as you will see, because I do this program. You'll see me on a match day, not many away games, I must admit, and that's through the finances that I don't currently have, and that's the same with a lot of people. I think that they do try and get to an away game and things, but you know, there's not always the money to. It's similar to going to a Premier League game in a way.
I don't want to use the word hobby, but I can't think of another word off the top of my head. But
of course.
For your own personal time to, you know, to follow and watch football, it's not cheap.
No,
I can understand. You know, football's a business, and they need to be competitive, you know, to stay afloat and to compete. But you know, you add, you know, the average Joe might have a family, you know, a mortgage, you know, bills, etc., etc., etc. So whatever throwaway income is left, a lot of people have to pick and choose. You know, obviously, if you're a student, or you know, if you don't have these commitments, you can sort of stretch your wallet a little bit further.
Yeah, definitely. Okay then. So let's move on to the next sort of chapter, and maybe sort of bring it a bit back to sort of the history of the club. Let's talk about if you can remember this far back. What sort of lasting memories do you have of the old stadium?
Surprisingly, quite a few.
Okay.
I was first taken to Lokes Park in a pushchair,
right.
Okay. So my dad tells me.
Okay.
I find that absolutely hilarious, because I couldn't imagine pushchairs being brought into this ground now.
No.
Lokes Park itself was almost a throwback to what football was like in the quote old days.
Yeah.
Again, from generations before, they said so much about the character the place had, you know, the supporters. Obviously, the big slope, it was notorious.
Yeah.
Some people used to say it was like a goal start. And I think it was like 15 feet or something from one end to the other. But the one abiding memory I have when I first started going is a lot of the football I don't remember, but I always remember we used to walk up the little side road through the little turnstile just next to where the Lokes Park gates were, which are now situated just outside.
Of course, yeah.
We would walk through to the gasworks end, and we would stand almost adjacent to where we stand now, funnily enough.
Oh, right, okay.
Which is quite strange. I've never asked my dad why we stand where we do, we just always have.
Okay.
And at half time, we would go round in a clockwise motion to the clock end, or the hospital end. That was something that sticks in my mind probably above everything else, because obviously when we moved here, you couldn't really move from where you are, and it was, from someone who's been brought up from amateur / non-league football, it was sort of, you know, what's going on, you know, and my dad's not a very good advocate of sitting down at grounds. Again, that's born out of coming from, you know, the non-league days where everything was basically terraced, and obviously we know about what happened for certain tragedies probably brought in the end of standing.
Yeah. And I think we are incredibly lucky to have a standing end, as it were, behind one of the goals outside. I think we are extremely lucky, considering all the things that, that went on in the late 80s, and obviously, you know, we never wish anything like that to ever happen again. So that's sort of maybe a lasting memory of that era as well. Let's talk a bit about the Wembley visits, the old Wembley visits, as we've been there to the new one. What were, if we sort of go through, obviously there was three memorable ones, 91, 93 and 94. I'm only 21 years old, as most of you will know. I think I was possibly maybe even 2 weeks old for the 94 game. So this will be an interesting, this will be interesting for me. What was sort of the memories that you have of the 91 and the 93 games?
Just coming off the back of leaving Lokes Park, it was like a massive roller coaster, because just to backtrack for just a second.
Yeah, of course.
When we were actually introduced to the ground, once it was completed, they actually had an open day for the supporters, and I can remember myself and my dad coming up to the ground.
Right. Okay.
And
to this ground.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
And with the exception of the old main stands, which is basically just next to where we're having this interview now, every part of the ground was terraced. Obviously, we didn't have the big stands opposite, and we didn't, and the away end was the same size as the home end at the far end there.
Right. Okay.
And it was like a step into the unknown. It was like you would look around, you would think, "Wow, you know, this is ours," and it gave you sort of pride, you know. And it was like a stepping stone into, you know, where are we going? And the remnants of the team that Jimmy Kelman had formulated, which I'd like to add that I don't think he gets enough credit for, Jim Kelman.
Of course.
The team that Martin O'Neill took over, it had all the parts, it just needed the moulding. And taking that little step forward into the Football League. That sort of culminated in those Wembley visits. That generation of players, I honestly think, is the best Wickham side I've ever seen. If we could get a time machine right now, I honestly think we'd walk the league. We'd walk it. Easy.
I think, I've not really seen it properly. And the only time I ever saw those players was when we had Legends games and things like that, and they were 50, 60 years old. But they could quite clearly still play. At that age,
I think if you've got the talent, the talent doesn't leave you, and the knowledge doesn't leave you. Obviously, your body slowly begins to give up on you.
Yeah. Okay. So, if we is it possible for you to maybe describe the emotions and sort of the day of the Wembley visit in 91?
The one thing I can remember is the whole town got behind it. No matter where you went in town or whatever was going on at school, you know, the local corner shop, everything and everybody was into it, you know. And it was like, for the first time, if you were to say the word, you know, Wycombe Wanderers, people wouldn't sort of scoff at you. Everyone was into it, and it sort of brought the community together.
Right.
And I remember when we went back into the town centre after we won the first one.
Yeah.
I've never seen the town absolutely covered with blue everywhere.
Do you think that would ever happen if we'd, for example, had beat Southend last season? Do you think that'd have been anything like that?
I see no reason why not. I remember when I was coming home from college, when we got to the semi-final of the FA Cup.
Right.
They held a open top bus parade for the players. It was almost like we won the thing.
Yeah, of course.
It wasn't quite to the magnitude of people that we had for the original Wembley run, but it was certainly close. That would be the abiding memory of the Wembley visits. From the actual stadium, obviously the old Wembley, it was all about tradition. And, you know, every kid's dream, you'd ever kicked a ball or lace up a pair of boots, wanted to play at Wembley. The next best thing would be and go and watch your team.
Yeah, definitely.
It was just like the new Wembley was the other season.
Of course.
It was basically, you know, wow, this is like, you know, a different planet.
Yeah. Of course, yeah. As it certainly was, I mean, I think I'd never been to the old one. I think I was 2001, 7 when they closed the old one.
2001, I believe, wasn't it? Something like that.
Yeah, I was, 2001. So, yeah, that was when they sort of finished playing there. Do you think if we'd have maybe made the final of the FA Cup in 2001, mm-hmm. We were very close, and I think most Wickham fans, deluded or not, would have said that we were possibly the better side in the semi-final against Liverpool.
Going back to that game, realistically, the only way we were going to win that game, we had to rely on restarts or set plays, however you want to call them.
Yeah.
The way Laurie Sanchez set the team up was to not concede. You know, we had a back five, and the idea was to press Liverpool in the same vein we do now. Mm. You know, not leak goals. And obviously Martin Taylor was, at the time, at his apex.
Yeah.
Wonderful goalkeeper. Mm.
Do you see comparisons between him and Matt Ingram, or any of the recent ones? Who maybe came close to him?
Matthew and Martin were totally different goalkeepers. I've played in goal my whole life, so I've got a little bit of an idea what I'm talking about in this regard. You know, I've played God knows how many games, albeit not at a high level, so the game doesn't change. Mm. And obviously Matt being a local lad, I'm fortunate enough to work with some guys who knew him growing up.
Yeah.
You know, his personality, his traits, etc. When he was a junior at Loudwater.
Right.
One of the things they would say, one of the things I noticed with him, he was very similar to me when I was young.
Right.
Or, I like to think I still am young, but a little bit younger.
Younger.
A little bit younger. He was very, almost in a shell. Very brave, but his personality was very closed off. Again, that's not a criticism.
I think that's the same with his social life as well. I mean, I think he was... I think there's a lot of people trying to maybe sort of find him on social media or anything, as anybody would do this age. Obviously, following all the players on Twitter and everything, and having that close knit thing. I mean, and Matt Ingram, he wasn't.
I think on the same notion, I think you've got to also respect the guy's privacy as well.
Of course, yeah.
Obviously, it's the way social media is today. It's your discretion whether you wish to use it.
Of course,
For whatever reason.
It's not compulsory at all.
But I think the thing with Matt is, and I'm sure he'll come out of his shell, because I certainly did few years into when I played. I think because he was almost the junior of the team, he didn't feel compelled to... And I'm not saying for a second you have to shout and bellow at people, but you just have to let them know you're there. You give clear and concise information, and you know, if somebody does something, you let them know, you know, such and such, you know, clear your minds, whatever.
Mm, yeah, definitely, yeah.
But again, that will come with experience.
Mm, of course.
And obviously you won't gain experience unless you play.
No,
you know,
definitely.
I mean, one of the things a lot of people have said online about young Alex, who unfortunately is out injured at the moment, and I wish him a full recovery.
Yeah, same.
I've seen enough in the games he has played to think, well, at the end of the day, he's at the club first and foremost. He's learning his trade, so he's obviously got a future in front of him. He basically needs game time.
Yeah. Definitely.
That's all he needs. I mean, you can practice until the cows come home. You know, you could do all the repetitions and, you know, training routines forever and a day, but at the end of the day, the goalkeeping profession, you live and die on your decision making.
Mm.
And you can't get out there and actually do that unless you get game time.
Of course.
And I think some of the supporters have been very unfair, you know, and some have been quite personal.
Mm. That never sort of... I've seen a lot of it recently, even in regards to sort of loyal supporters, thankfully, I'm not, as far as I'm aware, I haven't received anything like that, and I'm sure you possibly haven't.
No, it's just water off a duck's back anyway.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it's very very well and good that you have your opinions and you're entitled to voice them, but there's a way, ways and means, as we say. If you have something to say to the person, say it to them. There's a lot of supporters out there who sort of disagree with a lot of the decisions that all the managers have made in previous years. I mean, I sort of, to some extent, did disagree with the decision to sell Matt Ingram, but then when I saw the background into it, and I saw the potential money that could be made out of it, and I also oversaw the fact that Alex Lynch, his development, he'll become a better player because Matt has stepped aside and gone.
You'll never get better just sat on the bench.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, you look back to the 90s when we had Chuck Musadic as our reserve to Paul Hyde. Mm. He was there exclusively as a reserve. Obviously, yeah. We had a team in the reserve league at the time, which I believe was the Capital League. Yeah. I believe we won it one season. So he was playing matches.
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't have that luxury now. So unless these guys go out and actually do the business for other teams, they're literally sitting on the backsides, and you're sort of stalling your career.
Yeah, and obviously they're still being paid as well while they're sat on the bench. And I think that players don't really want to sit on the bench and get paid. They want to actually earn their money.
I think another thing is, you know, whether we want to admit it or not, you know, at the end of the day, they're trying to earn a crust, you know, for their families, for themselves.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you've got the opportunity to showcase your skills, that will give you the chance to move on and get better wages, you know, and security for yourself, your family. You want that opportunity, because if your stock drops in football, guess what? There's another 10 or 20 kids behind you
exactly.
who want your spot.
Yeah. Yeah. You know? Definitely. Yeah. Let's talk maybe one last little bit about some of the previous managers that we've had, and then after that we'll take a break and we'll reconvene after. So if we maybe go for let's go for who was the first manager that you. That managed Wycombe Wanderers since you'd followed them that you can remember.
Well,
was it Jim Kelman? Was it someone before?
It would have been Peter Sudderby or Jimmy Kelman after him. I can't remember the Sudderby time. He was only there for literally a year or 2 years.
Okay, that's fine.
I remember Jim Kelman because, funnily enough, I remember us getting knocked out of a cup competition against the Metropolitan Police.
Oh, right, okay.
You know, and I love the police. I think they're great people.
Of course.
You know, I've got a lot of friends who are coppers, and I've got all the time in the world for them, tongue in cheek.
Same here.
But that would have been the Jim Kelman low point, and I believe pretty soon after that, it may have been the game after, I believe he resigned from the team.
Right.
But his ideas and his philosophies that I've actually looked into were actually quite groundbreaking at the time for non-league football.
Yeah.
Obviously, the old-fashioned 4-4-2 was, you know, the go-to thing.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
He tried the sweeper system in the non-league, which was virtually unheard of, and he got moderate success with it, with the players he had. And you've got to look at the scouting around that time. Matt Crossley's dad would have been the chief scout for Wycombe.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Obviously, his son would have been one of the players... Yeah. Steve Guppy, who they tracked for several years, Dave Carroll, wonderfully talented footballer.
Oh, yeah.
I would love to have someone like that in the team now. You know, Steve Guppy, Glenn Creaser, who had a bit of a, let's just say they had a bit of an argument with Mark West at a Barnet game, and Barry Fry wanted him out, so Jimmy Kelman said, I'll take him. And that was the captain for that era.
Yeah.
Wonderful centre-half. And obviously people go on about Aaron today. Mm-hmm. Wonderful player. You know, Alfie Mawson last season.
Yeah.
Glenn Creaser was a good old-fashioned centre-half. Get your head in, get your foot in. You know, you're there to defend. That's your job. None of this fancy dance stuff, you know.
Yeah.
Players like that, you know, in the mould of, say, like a Terry Evans, you know, an old-fashioned defender.
Yeah, definitely.
Wonderful player. The Jimmy Kelman era, yes, would have been my first sort of real memories of him.
Yeah.
And then obviously Martin and Hill following directly afterward. Took that side, added to it, made it, it was a winning machine. When we first moved to this ground, we absolutely annihilated teams week in, week out. It was phenomenal. Scoring goals for fun, good football, winning football.
When Martin O'Neill took over, did you, apart from him obviously being a European Cup winner, a double European Cup winner, I think he was, they were both of
back-to-back,
European Cup wins. Did you know much about him? I think Wickham was possibly his first managerial job.
To the best of my knowledge, he started at a team called Grantham in the non-league.
Right, okay.
I believe he may have had a stint somewhere else. I'm not 100% sure on that. Okay. Some of the other supporters may
of course
know. But certainly this was the first job where he really made a name for himself.
Did you know anything about what he'd done?
Well, at the time, obviously you've got to appreciate I was about 7 to 8 years old.
Yeah,
so
of course,
my knowledge of the game was very limited, so any knowledge I did get was from my father.
Did he maybe...
I'm sure he was well aware who Martin O'Neill was and the accomplishments. I mean, he knows all of... I've heard so many stories about Brian Clough.
Yeah,
you know, so I'm more than aware that he would know his stuff.
Similarities between the two are probably seamless.
Yeah, the student and the teacher. Almost,
of course, yeah. So if we maybe go into, I know it was sort of early on in your years. What sort of was it an immediate impact that? Can you remember, was it sort of an immediate impact that when he came in, that was it, boom? Like some managers, new managers in the leagues these days, they sort of come in and it doesn't quite take them sort of 5 or 6 games, they're sort of bang, straight winning already.
I think what we touched upon earlier, the fact that the nucleus of the side was there, it made the transition a little bit easier. He didn't try and change too much too quickly. Mm. He basically saw that we had possibly two of the most talented wingers in the non-league, Dave Carroll, Steve Guppy.
Yeah.
And the team was all about utilising the width of the pitch. And we at the time, Mark West was a goal-scoring machine in the non-league. Today, if a player was banging in 30 goals a season for like 3 or 4 seasons, they'd be snapped up.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, obviously...
Quite how he wasn't...
I think that would probably be due to the fact that the money wasn't quite at the apex that it is today. Mm. I think one of the reasons he didn't move into the Football League with us, two reasons, he was starting to get on a bit and he couldn't guarantee his place in the side, and he felt he could earn more money retaining his job on top of the football on the side than what he could as a professional. Because obviously once your career's done, it's done.
Yeah, exactly.
No.
Okay then, so... Obviously, you've touched on this sort of winning machine mentality from Martin. I think I've never even seen him up close. Never sort of witnessed any of his Wickham Wanderers career sort of firsthand. What I know we've sort of touched on it previously about the winning machine and all this kind of thing. What sort of style of football, if you could maybe elaborate on what, was it the same style? Did he sort of say, okay, this season we're going to play this type of football and then change it when we go into the Football League or whatever? Or what kind of style would you say, I know you've touched on it before by saying playing wide and...
One of the biggest things I've noticed today, especially with the advent of football being on the telly a lot more often, is people will see teams at the top level and they'll be playing this, you know, expansive one-touch football. Mm. You know, nice to watch, but you know, it's all very well, you know, doing it when you're in front of the back line. It's what you do getting in behind them and creating chances.
Definitely.
I think his game was all about... There's three different types of passes in football. There's the short pass, there's the long pass, and there's the right pass.
Mm.
Because you can overplay sometimes.
Yeah.
On the other side,
as we've done many times this year, I feel.
On the flip side, you can also be too hasty, and you can, you know, try and hit the channels or hit the big man too quick. And as we touched upon before, it's great if you press and win the ball. If you give it back straight away, you've defeated the object.
Yeah, and we've done that plenty of times this year.
I think it's very easy for supporters to get on the backs of players, because obviously you've got a different view up in the stands. When you're down there doing it, you've got a split second to make a decision.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously if you don't have the options in front of you, your only option is then the furthest pass.
Yeah, of course.
But obviously that's a different thing we get into entirely.
Of course.
But the team itself, very similar to what we've got now. We wouldn't press as much or as high up, but the guys in the middle of the field, Keith Ryan, he was there to win the ball, you get the ball back and you give it to the ball players. You use the width of the pitch, and their job was to basically get to the touchline and get the crosses in. Mm. That was their job. You know, and simple. Yeah. Football's a very simple game, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, you can sugarcoat it, you know, forever, but it's such a simple game.
Yeah.
They would, you know, and the set plays or restarts from those guys was massive. And if you look back at the assists for half the goals, they're all on YouTube.
Yeah, you know, definitely.
Just have to flick through.
Yeah.
So many goals come from crosses.
Mm. Yeah. I do agree.
That was basically the foundation on what the Martin O'Neill side was made from.
I've sort of dabbled in the management myself, and I've sort of tried to base my sort of style on what we're doing at the moment, as it's relatively easy to sort of to look up and to research, you know, just have a look, and I'm sure people who were trying to, or people who were managers back then, tried to look at as many clips of things as they could, but you know, it's a lot easier now to look at things. Anyway. Enough about my unsuccessful managerial career of late. Let's talk about your maybe reactions to the end of Martin O'Neill's Wickham career. What were your thoughts?
It's a strange one, obviously.
Without bursting into tears would be nice.
Oh, I've done that already. Don't you worry, I've run out of tears.
Oh, good.
To be honest, obviously nothing lasts forever.
And
you can obviously outstay your welcome in some respects.
Did you expect it?
At the time, there was a lot of talk, I believe the season previous. It was Norwich he went to in the end.
Mm.
He fell out with the manager within a few months. We all know how that ended. But like we said with the players, you know, ideally, if he could have taken us into the division above when we missed out on the playoffs, when the leagues were being restructured, I honestly think he would have stayed. I honestly do, because it was then that one step away from what would have then become the Premiership.
Mm.
Obviously, the club at the time was in a lot better financial state. Obviously, we had the foundation of players.
And we could afford money to...
Yeah, it was expendable, let's say.
And I suppose with someone like Martin, I don't think he would use the fact that he's won two European Cups, that, oh look, I've won two European Cups, come play for me.
No.
I don't think he would have ever done that.
The thing with Martin was, he surrounded himself with a good team.
Mm.
He basically took the Brian Clough approach. He was the, you know, if you were to walk into a room, you could smell his aftershave. He, one of the quotes that Alan Smith said when he first came, he wanted to get rid of the scent of Martin O'Neill, because the players who were here at the time would like open the door and they would look for him, you know, where's he gone, you know. It was just, it was almost like he was the Don, like, you know, Don Reedy was at Leeds.
I could probably imagine the same thing might happen if Ainsworth was to leave.
That's totally understandable.
I could imagine that the same thing might happen.
From what I'm aware, Gareth's a very articulate gentleman. He's very well spoken. He's honest and to the point.
That's when he walks straight through the door and he hears you saying that.
And
I'm pulling your leg there.
but to be honest, you know, in any working environment, if you respect the guy who is the boss, you will run for a brick wall for him, or you will go that extra mile. If you don't respect your boss, I'll have a lazy day today. You know, that's in any job, you know. So if he kept his contact minimal with his players, he would only step in, you know, to G them up, or, you know, to point out something in particular. The coaches, like you see in the big clubs today,
yeah.
I guarantee Alex Ferguson wasn't doing any stop-start coaching at Man United.
No.
I guarantee you. But he was, his presence was always there. If you, like, spat and you sort of, you know, said something under your breath, you would look over your shoulder, oh, God, did he see that?
Yeah.
You know, because you obviously...
Or make sure he wasn't there before you said it.
But the fear of consequence was there. If you did something, you knew something was going to happen, you know.
Of course. Okay then, so after Martin O'Neill left for Norwich, as you said, there Alan Smith came in. Mm-hmm. I still hadn't followed, or I still wasn't sort of au fait with the club or involved with the club mm-hmm. at any point. Around 95, 96?
I believe it was around that time.
So I was 1 or 2 years old, so you can give me that credit. So Alan Smith, what sort of, again, this is from a supporter who wasn't around at that era, what went right and what went wrong?
Well, obviously, first and foremost, when Martin left, obviously Ivor and the board of directors at the time, you need a replacement. Mm. It's an unbelievably hard, you know, act to follow with so much success, like, you know, David Moyes walking at Manchester United,
yeah.
as you can appreciate. It was almost like a poison chalice. Mm. You know, no matter what you do, it's going to go wrong. He came into the club. You first and foremost, you want to put your seal on it. You know, it's got to be your side, your way of go, you know, philosophies.
And
it's
got this.
I think he changed too much too quickly.
Basically the complete opposite of Martin O'Neill when he first came in.
I think in his defence, the side was beginning to age.
Right.
Simon Garner was probably pushing 37, 38.
Right.
Cyril Regis, who I believe was released anyway, was about a year older. So
right.
they're literally on their last
yeah.
legs.
Right.
Wonderful footballers. Great favourites, and obviously the supporter in the stand doesn't look at how old they are. If they're doing the business, they don't want to see them go.
Yeah, just like Ainsworth when he was out on the pitch.
Yeah.
And Hayes and Thompson.
You sometimes forget the age, you know, and you just
yeah.
look at what's in front of you.
Yeah.
And, you know, you've got to face the facts that, you know, you've got to eventually get the new blood in.
Yeah.
I think Alan Smith tried to change too much too quickly.
What was the sort of... What sort of signings did he bring in? I mean, was it sort of, I've come in through the door, I'm going to bring 5 or 6 in straight away? Or
I think when he came in...
Were there any sort of notable people that...
There were a few players who came in who, for whatever reason, just never found their form. And again, because of the side we had previous that was doing so well, it was like a shock to the system. We've had
right.
4, 5, 6 years of wonderful success, and all of a sudden we're starting to stutter. And supporters are naturally going to get on the manager's back. It happens. Alan Smith said a few things in the programme notes that were a little derogatory towards the supporters. And again, the Free Press covered it. Again, I don't know if it was misquoted. But he got on the wrong side of a lot of people for his comments. And the style of football changed dramatically. We became literally a Route 1 side. The players who came in to basically take over from the aging players who had left were not doing the business, and ultimately it
was. Was there anyone that did?
Let's see. Well, Dave Farrell came in from Aston Villa, hit and miss. You know, again, Steve Guppy, unbelievably hard act to follow.
Mm.
Never really. Again, injured a lot, never really did the business. We'd probably have one game where it was 9 out of 10 and another 3 or 4 games where it was like 3 out of 10.
Yeah. So sort of you have that 9 out of 10 game and you sort of be expecting to go, oh, hold on a minute, I'm going to be...
The next
yeah.
big thing, yeah.
Yeah, and then he doesn't.
But there was a few players who came in, but I think the main thing was he basically dismantled the team that was inherited by him. A lot of players moved on. You know, again, I wasn't at the training session, so I can't really make
comparisons.
You know, it's unfair to speculate in that regard, but the nucleus of the side was ripped apart, and what he put together was not really, it was basically substandard
yeah.
to what we had. And obviously, getting on the back of the supporters was possibly the first nail in the coffin.
Mm.
And okay. obviously, as we know, the game itself is about results, whether we like it or not. You know, you don't get the results, you're going to be in trouble. And Ivor Meeks is quite notorious for not letting people hang around too long.
Yes.
You know.
There was something that he did bring to Wickham that maybe went a bit unnoticed.
Yes, definitely.
Was the youth setup? Would you, as a supporter of that era, what sort of, were there any sort of notable names that came through that youth setup that we would recognise from memory, of course?
Just to add to that,
yeah.
I can't stress enough, for whatever people say about Alan Smith, he was the guy who started off the entire system of the youth team.
Right.
And as we touched on before, and we really need that back as soon as possible.
Yeah.
I can't stress
yeah.
that enough. But he was the one who actually started out. I believe Neil Smiley was the first one. Obviously, he went on to be the manager for a little while.
Yeah.
Maybe the step up was a bit too much for him. Very nice guy.
Mm.
But the youth side, at the time, I think the first player to break through to the first team and get a run was probably Morris Harkin. He
right.
was about 17, 18 at the time.
Okay.
And he looked like he could, you know, he looked like he had a career in front of him.
Yeah.
Good on the ball, skillful, a little bit lightweight, but he was the first one to come through. But the foundation of the youth setup was there.
Right.
You can't expect okay. 10, 11 players just to come straight into the first team and do the business.
Mm.
Obviously, this isn't FIFA.
No.
Or, you know,
of course,
or
yeah.
Football Manager. You
yeah.
know? You know, we're talking about real life, so
yeah.
you know, you've got to embed these players slowly. But the setup was up and running.
Yeah.
And the club really should be indebted to Alan Smith in that regard. Mm. If he didn't bring anything to the club, that was the one thing he did.
Yeah.
And obviously, in the last 5 years or so, whatever it is, 8, 9 years, we've virtually seen, you know, the best in regards to what we've produced.
Of course.
Matt Phillips, you know, possibly was the first one.
Yeah.
You know, who else? You know, Matthew, who's just left us.
Yeah.
Oh God, there's loads off the top of my head. You know, Kadeem Harris, Jordan Ibe, who.
Yeah.
Hopefully, we're going to get some future revenue from.
Fingers crossed.
Even if it's just to
Fingers
clear the
crossed.
Debt for the club to make sure we stay afloat. Fantastic.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, definitely. I think that was. I mean, from what I've sort of seen, I mean, the youth setup is something that we need to get back as soon as possible. I mean, I'm probably not going to be the last person to say that, or yourself. But if there is sort of any way that we can sort of try and help to get that back, then we do need to. Okay, let's move on. Move on from there. If we talk about after Alan Smith was John Gregory.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this was possibly. I mean, I was maybe. What sort of year did he come in?
I believe it was 96, 97 he took over.
Okay.
Neil Smiley took over. We literally got hammered at Peterborough. We got stuffed.
Right.
And Alan Smith, I believe, was relieved of his duties within a day or so.
Right. Okay.
Neil Smiley took over as sort of interim manager, is what it's called today.
Yeah.
Caretaker manager, whatever you want to call it. And he steadied the ship for a few matches. Again, not the best football to watch, but we were picking up points. John Gregory was brought in from Aston Villa. He was a coach there under Brian Little at the time. Very likable man, very witty. He was what you would call a disciplinarian. He was quite notorious for fining players for shooting outside the box, which I can't get my head around that. I can sort of half understand where he was coming from in some regards, but if you don't shoot, you don't score. But on that same notion, you don't want to be shooting from ridiculous distances and angles at the same time either. You know, if the goal opens up and there's a chance to hit the ball,
yeah,
have a pop.
Yeah.
If it goes in the car park, so what? You've had a go.
As long as it doesn't hit your windscreen, you're fine.
That's true, yeah.
There you go. let's maybe talk a bit about what he brought to the football club in terms of the players again that he brought in.
I think first and foremost he stabilised the sinking ship at the time. That was paramount.
Yeah,
you know, kept us up.
To stop you there. When Neil Smiley was in charge, mm-hmm. did you ever see him taking the job permanently? Did you ever think he would?
It was literally for no more than three, four games.
Right.
And then Gregory came in. To be honest, from what I heard in the free press, or read in the free press, I should say, he was one of the final candidates to get the job.
Neil Smiley.
Yeah.
Right.
As he was already inside. Football club. Obviously, Ivor Beeks and those in charge at the time obviously went for a more experienced individual. I can totally understand that.
Mm, yeah,
not
definitely.
A problem.
Yeah,
totally understand that. But I think with Neil Smiley, he came across as almost soft, if you like.
Right.
And I don't mean that.
Is that because of maybe lack of experience, do you think?
Personality.
Well, because he's used to working with younger players?
I would assume it'd be a lot different working with young players. Obviously, you're working, I would say, at the age of about 12 to 15 is probably the single most important time for a player's career, because obviously you're growing physically, you know, you're changing physically, you're learning the game. You know, when you get to 23, 24, 25, you basically know
of
business.
Course. Yeah, yeah.
You
definitely.
Need to put it into action. Mm, you know,
definitely.
So you don't really want to go overboard on young players. You know, obviously everybody's different,
right.
But you don't want to make
of course.
People go into their shell. So
yeah,
possibly,
definitely.
Possibly working with a senior side would be a lot different than working with a youth side. I can understand that side of it.
Okay. Yeah, let's go back to the John Gregory era. I mean, was the style of play maybe the same under John than it was with Martin? Did you see comparisons, or was it completely different?
It was different. The one thing he changed, and him and his assistant Richard Hill at the time, first and foremost, they got to stop the ship from sinking. So the one thing they noticed was we were leaking a lot of goals.
Yeah.
So what they did, they changed the back line from a back four into almost a back five. It was basically three centre halves with wing backs, and the width would come from the wing backs. Jason Cousins, when he was still quite mobile, was on the right, and Mickey Bell, I think, is one of the best left backs this club's ever had from an attacking standpoint. The guy could cross a ball, and he was lightning. Good defender as well. Obviously, he left in a certain cloud.
Of course. Yeah.
So obviously, a lot of supporters will obviously not forgive him for that. But that's another story.
Yeah.
But as a player, the one thing I noticed with him that I don't see today from our players, from fullback, is when the space is open to run into, you run into it, and people panic. You know. Joe Jacobson's a fantastic defender, but what I find is when he's the outlet and the ball comes to him, he's almost frightened to run into that space. He's looking for the ball in the box straight away, or he's looking for an outlet ball.
Maybe essentially that's what he's been told to do.
I can understand that. Yeah, I can understand that.
Maybe Cedo's or whoever's playing right back, whether it be Jason, Cedo, Michael, whatever. Mm. Maybe they're the ones. Maybe they've been told.
We'll touch on this in a minute, because I think Jumbati could be utilised in a different way, but that's my personal opinion,
right.
But we'll get to that in a second.
Right, carry on.
But, under Gregory, basically, the team was set up to stop conceding goals.
Right.
Once it's started to click with players, because you can understand, if you start changing systems and formations overnight, you're going to be confused, who do I pick up and which runner do I track and, little things like that. So they got to get used to it. So obviously for the first few weeks it was a bit hit and miss.
Okay.
But the side was steady, if unspectacular. The football, when they got the ball down and played, which is with all Wickham sides, they play, they can cut teams open. down the years, with all the personnel we've had, we've always had, you know, decent footballers.
Yeah.
But he sort of, and the thing with Gregory was, he was very good at getting the fans on his side. Martin Taylor was one of his signings that season.
Okay.
Was on the verge of almost England recognition before he broke his leg at Southend.
Wow.
Again, that's another story.
Yeah, of course.
He brought back Keith Scott.
Okay.
Albeit not the same Keith Scott we saw a few years earlier.
Yeah.
But still could do a good job at the level he was playing at and a massive fan's favourite.
Okay. If we... I think that seems a good natural stopping point. If we stop there, and guys, if you tune in a couple of minutes, we'll be back.
Pay the money and go. It's really good.
And get the seat.
It's the best show I've
for
seen.
For a long time.
Wonderful show. The singing was absolutely beautiful.
Lauren basically is Edith Piaf. Please go and see.
Guys, and welcome back to Chair Boys 1887. I'm here with Russell Thomas, and we're currently at Adams Bar. We're just going to come back to what we were talking about before the break, and that was the John Gregory revolution, impact, whatever you want to call it. What was the sort of general feeling when he came in?
First and foremost, he was brought in to steady the ship that was left. Sinking under the Alan Smith regime. That's first and foremost. We had to stay in the division we were in.
Yeah.
Obviously, being relegated cost the club revenue, you know, via sponsorship, supporters, etc., etc. So that came first. He did it. He was successful that season. The nucleus of the side that he brought in was what I suppose you would call the forerunner to the backbone of what became the FA Cup semi-final side. Michael Simpson was one of the first people he brought in from Notts County. Footballer, very good footballer.
Hell of a player.
He got a lot of stick from people in the terrace and the crowd. They accused him of overplaying, but at the end of the day, if you're a footballer, you're going to give the ball away sometimes. But everything through the team went through Michael Simpson. Mm. Everything, you know.
Yeah, I could see why as well. And it worked.
John Cornforth was brought in, former Welsh international, similar sort of player. He was basically brought in as almost Dave Carroll's replacement, but obviously
too late.
He never really found his form. Carroll was still doing the business. Again, Carroll could have played on until he was 50, easy. Easy could have played on until he was 50, you know, and Carroll was doing the business and Cornforth wasn't, and he was obviously on a higher wage, and that's probably another thing we could touch on. A lot of the players John Gregory brought in were probably brought in on slightly higher wages than the average Division 2.
Is that probably just to get them in through the door? And
it's hard to say. I wouldn't want to second guess his judgment. Yeah. He obviously brought them in for the correct reasons. You know, they were good enough, and he needed to do a job.
Yeah.
And obviously, at the time, we did have some capital to spend with.
Yeah.
Not a huge amount,
but
there was still money left from the success of the years previous under Martin O'Neill. But we started living probably outside of our means at the time, and it's hard to say. I mean, you can't really see 20 years into the future thinking we're going to be penny pinching all of a sudden. Certainly
spend it while it's there, right?
For the short time John Gregory was here, he steadied the ship and he started to build the side that eventually would go on to be the backbone for the semi-final run under Laurie Sanchez.
Okay, thank you very much for mentioning his name, because that is where we moved to. The Laurie Sanchez era, I mean, that was when I sort of just started to sort of become aware of the Wycombe Wanderers team and who they were and what they were and all the rest of it. Did you think that Laurie Sanchez would have the success they did when he came in? Did you know who he was when he came in?
Yes, I did know who he was. It's quite well documented about the underdog success story of Wimbledon.
Yeah.
And again, probably the last remnant of what you would call lower league football played in the top division.
Yeah.
The Wimbledon style, the crazy gang, it's very well documented. On a small side note, Wimbledon were in a very similar situation to where we were when we were in the non-league.
Yeah.
And they didn't even have their own ground.
No.
We did. They proved that, you know, they could go straight up through the leagues, and they survived up there for many years. And unfortunately, you know, we all know what happened there.
Yeah.
We won't go into that because I don't want to upset the other half of Buckinghamshire.
No.
You know, I'd like to sleep without, you know, with one eye open, let's say. You know.
Yeah, we don't want to do that. We're all about making friends, hopefully. In terms of the, if possible, did you ever see the success coming? Did you see it coming with Laurie Sanchez? I know it was a relegation bout to start with, similar to the one we had a couple of years ago.
Sure.
I don't know whether it was of the same magnitude.
It was probably worse.
Right.
At one point, we were virtually dead and buried.
Was it in League Two or was it League? Because this is the bit that I got confused.
This is where the divisions have been changed all over the place.
Was it the old division?
If you want to say, forget the Premier League, if you want to go 1, 2, 3, 4,
yeah,
it would have been the old Division 3.
Okay.
Which is now effectively League One.
Right, okay.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
I've had many conversations with my mother. She doesn't understand it, and I get very... I've actually got a bald patch here where I'm pulling my hair, trying to write it down on bits of paper. I still love you, Mum. But, that was basically the time period.
Yeah.
And, it was almost... It was very similar to the Ronnie Moore situation at Hartlepool. I honestly thought Hartlepool were finished.
Yeah.
It was almost identical. The results started coming. And obviously, we went up to Manchester City, and we did the double over in that season. Fantastic! Never saw that coming.
No,
never. In fact, I was up here for the home game, and one of the Gallagher brothers was actually up in the, I believe it was the executive boxes.
Wow. With
some of his mates.
Wow.
And we were throwing some, let's just say, some friendly advice his way.
Okay, fair enough.
Wow. It was fun, and he enjoyed it. He, you know, gave it back, and
of course.
All the power to him. I love Oasis. I think they're fantastic.
Yeah.
But on that particular day, he wasn't one of my mates. Not at the top of the Christmas card list.
It doesn't matter. He's a Manchester City supporter, so.
But
you know.
Yeah, we beat Manchester City at the old Main Road ground. Never saw that coming. We beat Wigan, who were literally champions elect that season, here, And then we went on to that day at Lincoln. Correct me if I'm wrong, I think Barry Richardson might have been in goal for Lincoln that day. I'm not 100% certain.
Interesting.
But I think you might have to ask him that.
I might have to ask him that
because I know he was at Lincoln around that time period, so I might be wrong.
But possibly Gareth Ainsworth might have been sniffing around that
time. I believe he was.
Maybe
he might have been at Preston or QPR at the time. I'm not sure. Again, we'll have to ask him.
Yeah, we'll have a look.
But
get in touch.
Wonderful. I never saw the escape come in. I was literally expecting to be playing in the division below. We stayed up, and the next season, we signed Sean Devine at the back end of the relegation season.
Yeah.
Banging in goals, another lower league goal scorer, something we just haven't had, you know, since. On the same notion, you need to create chances for them as well. That's another story.
If we'd have gone down that year, would we have bounced straight back up?
It's hard to say because the irony is losing breeds losing. You know, football is a confidence game like any sport is. Yeah. If you're not doing the business, and other teams are.
Yeah.
You know, I would back a team promoted from the division below to do well against the team from division relegated because winning breeds winning.
Yeah, it's true.
You know.
Yeah.
Obviously, there will be certain players within there who may have a little bit more technical ability, but you know, when confidence is down, you know, I mean, hard work trumps. You know, there was a saying. Talent loses to hard work or something like that.
Yeah.
You know. Than
of course.
Whatever it is.
Oh, I don't know. Okay. Let's maybe go push it on a couple of years. I think that was the survival was sort of 1999, I think. Alongside the greatest year in one of the greatest years in my Premier League team's history, of course.
What happened to Carl then?
No, I don't know actually. Yeah. You'll have to remind me. only joking. Of course, I remember. Let's maybe push it forward 2 years, in fact, or maybe, 2 years. 2001, the famous FA Cup run.
Wonderful memories.
First question I've got to ask is, did you go to the Liverpool game?
Yes, along with probably the entire town. Again.
Did you see the same sort of, we talked about the Wembley visits, 91, 93, 94. Was it the same impact? I mean, I think we possibly did mention this before, but just to touch on it again, did you see maybe the same thing, like all the sea of blue that you spoke about?
Yeah, it was exactly the same? Very reminiscent. The only difference being, it wasn't Wembley. Villa Park is a wonderful football ground. It's a lovely football ground.
Did you go this year?
I didn't. Work, unfortunately, I work a night shift,
okay,
so unfortunately fine. Work comes first.
No, of course, I can understand that.
But it's a lovely football ground. Villa's got a fantastic history.
Mm.
And one of the main gripes of mine today is Wembley is not used as the showcase for the final like it used to be. You know, they go to Wembley for the semis.
Yeah.
It totally diminishes the idea of getting to Wembley, in my opinion.
It'd be like, I suppose you could draw comparisons with the playoffs. Having the playoffs at Wembley, the playoff semi-finals at Wembley.
Yeah.
The
playoffs are another one that certainly my dad doesn't agree with, because if you finish, say, 20 points better off than the team who beat you in the final, how's that fair? You know?
Yeah.
Again, that's another can of worms you can openly discuss.
I suppose, obviously, in League Two, you've got 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th. 4th place 7th, 5th place 6th.
But on the same notion, it's also a great chance for teams to get to Wembley who may not necessarily get there. It's a double-edged sword.
I didn't really think that we were going to get that far. Once we got to Wembley,
When we got into the playoffs and I saw the team we had, I was very confident.
Mm.
I was very confident.
When I saw that we drew Plymouth, I thought, oh God. Because I saw their side and I thought, yeah, their side's a very good side. And John Sheridan at the time had that team ticking along very nicely.
On the same notion, we were exactly the same, I think. Again,
I would have preferred to play Stevenage or Southend.
Yeah, it's strange, isn't it? Different kettle of fish, isn't it?
And I actually do remember saying, I don't want to play Plymouth. Mm. I do not want to play Plymouth in the semi-finals, even though we absolutely battered them.
I think as long as you stick to your guns and worry about what you're doing and you do the business, don't worry about what the opposition's doing. Because the Wickham side is set up today basically to stop the opposition playing. And I know there's a lot of criticism online about, you know, time wasting, this, that and the other. You know, I know Wickham are a little bit notorious for it.
So is every other team.
Thank you very much, you beat me to it.
No,
you
know, worries.
At the end of the day...
Funny enough, Plymouth actually did it at the weekend previous to playing us. So,
yeah. Funny that. But again, you know, game management in football has existed since the game was invented.
Yeah.
You know, it's just that now, like with media, literally you can't turn around a corner without a camera. You know, there's someone in an armchair, you know, saying, oh, you did this or you went down. It happens.
Yeah.
Who do you blame? The football clubs for exploiting the laws of the game, or do you blame the authorities for allowing the, you know, for allowing it to happen?
True.
It's a Chinese puzzle, isn't it?
Exactly. Okay. Let's maybe touch on one. Let's maybe bring it a little bit back to the FA Cup run. When we made the semi final, or when we got to the semi finals, before we'd even played Liverpool, do you think we could beat them? I know it's a.
They were a class apart. At the time, they were a solid side, Liverpool.
So they were a solid side. Unofficial trouble, didn't they? I suppose.
I honestly think if we would have drawn Tottenham, I think we'd have got to the final. Tottenham were struggling big time that season. They were really struggling, and I think when Laurie Sanchez set the team out against Liverpool, as we stated before, it was set up to not let Liverpool score. So whenever we had the ball, we were looking to basically hit Andy Rammel, and then we would sort of feed off the scraps, and then, you know, our attacking threat would come from our restarts.
Yeah. Pretty much like the Aston Villa game.
I still think Villa were there for the taking. I really think they would. I honestly thought there were a couple of times in that game where we got the ball on the deck and we really caused them some problems. I still think, again, I don't want to second guess the manager. All the time in the world for Gareth Ainsworth. I still think he could have been a bit braver. And, you know, touching back on what we said about Djumbati, I think he'd made a fantastic sweeper.
Yeah, there's been times where he's played at centre-back and I thought, wow.
I think he's great in the air, he's good on the ball. Don't, you know, let the guys either side him do the man marking and let him have a free role and go into midfield and let him express himself. You've got your extra option to give the, you know, you've got someone to give the ball to who's comfortable with it. He might be able to make things happen. They tried it the other week actually with Jason McCarthy.
Oh yes.
It didn't quite work, but I could see where they were going with it, because for the first 15 minutes I'm thinking, I'm liking this, and then
if they'd have probably tried it with Cedar, it might have.
I honestly think there's something, you know, I mean, obviously I'm not going to second guess the manager because I don't see the training.
No, of course.
From what I've seen of Djumbati, there's something about him that I think he could do a job in that role. You know, that's just my personal opinion.
Of course.
But getting back to the cup.
Yeah.
You never see cup runs coming, especially right deep into the later rounds, because at the time we had never got past the third round.
No.
Going back to when we were a non-league side, Middlesbrough. In the 70s was like the big game, you know, and we've never surpassed it since. And I'd love to be able to talk about that, but I wasn't around.
No, of course.
But this particular cup run, we drew teams who were sort of close enough to us where they were beatable. You know, obviously Millwall in the second round, we had the typical banana skin in the first round against Harrow. They were dangerous. I remember Martin Taylor pulled some saves off, and eventually, you know, the class showed.
Yeah.
Millwall were flying high in the league in the second round. I thought, right, that's it, finished. We basically went to their place, got the win, great. I think it was Grimsby in the next round. I thought, right, finished. We played terrible up here, but we nicked an equaliser, got to their ground, we played them off the park, and then it was Wolves and Wimbledon. And Wimbledon, I'm gutted I didn't go to Wimbledon. I'm gutted because from what I hear, that was like literally heart attack stuff, especially in the penalties when we went to like the goalkeepers taking. It's a bit like when you go to the toilet, you know, I've got to go to the toilet and you miss two goals or something, yeah. You know, oh, for God's sake, you know.
Yeah.
But, and I remember, right, we went to Filbert Street to play Leicester. I thought, right, this is our cup final. It's a day out. Steve Guthrie was there. We could pay tribute to him. We were matching them. And I'm thinking, well, Leicester are doing all right this season. And all of a sudden, then, you know, the pressure's on them.
Yeah.
Because the crowd are getting on their backs. The winner from Easendoe, totally another story I'd love to touch on in the next one.
Yeah, of course.
Literally, you could not write the script. It was Royal Rovers, you know. I mean, Teletext doesn't even exist anymore.
No,
you know,
no.
You'd probably, today, you'd probably go on to Twitter or something. I need a forward, you know. And
hopefully it doesn't get that bad for Gareth in the coming weeks and years that he's in charge. That he has to go to social media to find a striker. But if it works like Roy, then
it would certainly generate some media interest, though.
Mm.
And
then he scores the winner.
As Barry Richardson has got some interests for now. I would love to know if he's the oldest player ever to play for the club. I know he is in the Football League by a mile.
Yes.
I would love.
Yes, he is.
Really?
Yes.
Ever?
Yes, I think.
That's
he is.
Interesting.
I think he is.
And I would love to know who comes close second. I'll ask you about that after the camera goes off.
But, that'd be interesting.
But the cup run.
We might film that. We might not.
We got to Liverpool. To play Liverpool, sorry, at Villa Park.
Yeah.
Great day out. Brought back all the memories of Wembley. Really enjoyed the day out. Again, looking back on it, I still think we could have done a little bit more because we were almost frightened of Liverpool's class. You know, we seemed to be frightened to come out of our own half at times.
Yeah. Soak it up.
But again, you don't want to then, you know, sell out and then give them easy goals at the same time because Robbie Fowler was still class and Michael Owen was still in his pomp. So
Eskie as well.
We'll leave that for another day. Can still do a job though.
Yeah, true.
Can still do a job.
Okay. There's one last thing that I've asked Russell to do for me. I mean, I couldn't not ask him to do this. There's basically he's been a supporter of the club since we were at Lokes Park. I've asked him to pick his favourite 11 Wycombe Wanderers players, and he's going to explain this. I'm going to run through it with him, and he's just going to roughly explain sort of just why you picked them. Let's go with Paul Hyde, the goalkeeper. Why have you picked him?
This position was possibly the toughest choice for me.
If you didn't pick him, who would be a second choice? The substitute goalkeeper.
Martin Taylor, John Granville.
Okay, so if we go back to your choice, why did you pick Paul?
Paul Hyde for me was the complete goalkeeper. I think first and foremost, great shot stopper.
Mm-hmm.
You expect that.
Mm-hmm.
Same with the centre half. You expect him to head the ball.
Yeah.
Great handling. Great presence on the pitch. Commanded his area well, commanded the people in front of him well, confident goalkeeper,
yeah.
Very good decision making, and he wasn't frightened to clatter into defenders. He would come like right to the edge of his box to clump for balls, and it would give everyone confidence. And his distribution was very good as well,
okay.
Either by hand or by feet. Great servant of the football club, cool. And an absolute travesty why he left the club under Alan Smith. Probably the first nail in Alan Smith's coffin.
Okay. Right back, Jason Cousins.
Epitomises the football club. Very good footballer. Doesn't get the credit he should.
Yeah.
Good finisher.
Mm-hmm.
One of the most determined, tenacious defenders I've seen for the football club. Never say die, and he leaves every single inch out on that pitch. Gareth Ainsworth would love to have someone like Jason Cousins in his side. If you could rewind the clock 20 years, I guarantee you...
Get that magic time machine out again.
He will be playing. He is a Gareth Ainsworth player. I guarantee you he'll be out there now if he could.
Okay, next one. Terry Evans.
Man Mountain, an old-fashioned defender, not comfortable with the ball on the floor, but he won literally everything in the air, apart from when he played Kevin Francis, who was about 8 feet tall when he was at Birmingham. Great leader, great organiser, sort of a calm authoritarian about him on the pitch. I believe it was Martin O'Neill's final season here where he literally carried the team on his own for a period of time when Keith Scott left. He was literally, if we got a corner or a free kick, there was an air of expectancy. It was, where's Terry Evans, you know, aim for him. He was that good in the air as a, you know, a threat in the air, you know, almost like Aaron Pierre is today.
Okay guys, so we're going to stop there and we're going to wrap it up. We're going to do a second part later on. So stay tuned on Moving On TV. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter and on Instagram. Yeah.